But there are tons of skills that do. For example, clearly not voice and speech. Part of my training was really movement based, which means that we would try to find the emotional content of movement. And if I were to say to you, okay, punch, and that's kind of a kindergarten action, I say punch, then you would punch physically. You'd literally punch. And then you would find out the feelings that would bring out there. And you can have all the million different ways that you can punch, right? You can punch slow. You can punch sharp and quick. You can punch with tension. You can punch with ease. And that's the way we describe like a physical action. So that was one of the things that we would work on a lot in school, is the physical and emotional nature of physical action. And that really translates really well to voiceover. Because a lot of times people ask me, where do you find the emotion that goes along with that character? And I use physical actions, and I can be physical behind the microphone, and without having to like know everything about a character's backstory or write 10 pages of some fictional history for them, I just know, what's this character doing right now? Oh, he's kind of frothing. It's a weird adjective. And then I can just kind of froth with my voice, whatever that means to me. And that's a technique that was taught to me, and that's a technique that I use in voice acting, among many others. It's not all just frothing. But that experience, that education, I am all for formal education in acting. It is not necessary if you want to pursue it as a future, but it is something I say to people who want to make acting a profession. You need to get some kind of training first. There are fundamentals and technique involved that allow you to be a professional, and you might have all the emotional content, but if you don't have the fundamentals, you know, you could be the most skilled basketball player in the world, but you gotta have those fundamentals, baby. And I got mine from theater, but you can get them from other places too. Yeah, did I answer your question? Yes, two for two. All right, we'll make you do the walk. Oh no, okay. Hey! Very nice.
Okay, so obviously in Final Fantasy 15, one of my favorite things was the banter that the Chocolate Bros have amongst each other when they're going across.
Did you call them the Chocolate Bros?
No.
I like that one too.
Chocolate also works.
I'm afraid to look at your internet search history.
A lot of prompts.
Promptus.
Then this isn't related to Promptus.
I feel like when that game came out, it like crashed Archive of Our Own.
Yes.
Like, just no more. Yes, what was your question?
So among like the banter and exchanges in the game, what is either your favorite line or your favorite banter exchange that you've
done? Oh, the bad pun. Yeah, you can go back. The bad puns are some of my favorite because the great thing about Prompto is that he's self-aware. Like, I think Prompto is kind of like, I don't know, like the Deadpool goofy sidekick of video games. Like, I think Prompto knows he's in a video game, for sure. What was some of the other one? Is that, way to knock him out! And then, but what we did with the game, he doesn't just do that. After it's over, he kind of goes, like, you know, like, he knows that he's telling a bad joke. He's self-aware that he's telling a pun. So I think some of that was born out of Danny Inouye, the scriptwriter, and then later Matt Furta took over. Once we became aware that Prompto was self-aware, the writing started to change a little bit. So, and a lot of that was due to Keith Farley, the director. So that character evolved a little bit into... We always went into it knowing we didn't want it to be another Riku or another Vanille or another insipid Final Fantasy. Not that those characters are bad, they're just a lot. And we knew Prompto was a lot. So how do we make Prompto a lot, but also make him likable and real? And that was a big discussion I had as a Final Fantasy fan with the director and the scriptwriters, is how do we take this character and make sure that he stays grounded even while he's being a total idiot. So the banter is a big part of where that happens. And the banter's freeing because it's not quite so tied to the overarching story. So they play like little vignettes, and you can just put them anywhere and they make sense. Now, of course, I love the call-outs. I mean, I hate them and I love them, you know what I mean? It's like, oh, love the lighting. It's like, while I was playing through that, I was like, I can't hear this line one more time. I was like, I hate me. You know, and I know Adam, and I'm like, a new recipe. God, we know, Adam. Just tell me you want to eat a sandwich in a different way. But that's sort of the love, right? That's what you remember. They become the catchphrases. But I really love banter. We recorded thousands and thousands of lines of dialogue, not all of which made the cut. I think a big turnkey moment was when we were recording the Duske demo that came first. A lot of things got figured out there. I mean, heck, Knox's voice changed completely. He went from Batman to, you know, younger guy. And that was all, we found that all out in the demo. And I think one of the watershed moments was, snakes, why do you have to be snakes? And we all kind of stopped. And we went, wait, does Indiana Jones exist in this universe? And we all went, yeah, fuck yes, it does. And at that moment is where we were like, okay, let's make those jokes. Let's make a joke about leveling up in an RPG. Let's make other movie references, you know? And that's something that I feel like sometimes gets lost in translation when we dub something from Japan to the West. We lose those cultural sort of little jokes and trademarks that become part of Western culture. And so like, you know what? We're doing a worldwide release, a simultaneous release with Japanese. This is as much our game as it is theirs from a performance standpoint. Let's own it. So that a lot of that stuff started popping up. They let me sing little songs like, why does Prompto know the Final Fantasy victory? Because he knows he's in a Final Fantasy game. So yeah, those, I had a lot of favorite moments from that. Yeah, the banter was, and it came last too. So we knocked out the story and then we would come in and keep doing banter. I mean, I would come and be like, what'd you say? Yeah, can't help myself. It's forever. Remember, Prompto's 85% me, 15% bad hair. There's like 8 of you wearing like wings. So we're taking it personally. Yes, I'll do another one. Yeah, how about you, right up front? We'll get to everybody, I think. We got an hour.
So Max was here last year.
Max Middleman.
Yeah.
Oh,
we had
Max.
We had a nice like 30 people panel. He taught us a lot of beatbox.
He's great, isn't he?
He's great.
He's a great beatboxer.
So two questions actually. Do you know how to beatbox?
Ooh, I can, but I'm nowhere good as Max is. Max can do the like the scratching stuff.
Yeah.
My skills are not as good. We do it together though. Yeah.
So yeah, he was telling us about how he improv something for Breadwinners as like the cloud monster or whatever.
He did. Well, and that's where Max and I met, was Breadwinners. Yeah. Before any of this. Yeah.
So are there any like improv moments from, I guess anything, it could be Breadwinners, but any improv moments you've had that made the cut that were?
Oh, sure. I mean, if we're still on the Final Fantasy topic, when he sings, when you're in Kosselmark, and he's like, stairs going down, down, down. And he's like singing about like going into the dungeon. It's definitely, I was like, can I sing this? And like, I don't know, what's it gonna sound like? And it's like, yeah, I think so. It's tougher in video games because things are more scripted. You got a little more freedom in cartoons, but yeah, definitely. Well, I was doing this one show and there was a scene where both of the main characters were like gasping at something, but they're eating tacos. And the director was there, and I was like, would it be funny if the tacos gasped back at them? And they were like, yes! And I was like, good! And then we got a script later that said, tacos also gasp. And I was like, oh, I made the cut! The gasping tacos! Yeah! But yeah, definitely in Westerns. What'd you say? It's a show called Get Blake. It's another cartoon. Yeah, it was made in France, and it went for like, they put all 52 episodes on Nicktoons in a year and then it went away forever. Things like that happen. Yeah, but it's a fun show. Do you guys know Evangelion at all?
Yeah,
the English voice of that Spike Spencer who played the main kid, me and him were opposite each other in that show. Spike's a lot. He's a lovable little guy. I like him a lot. Yeah. That was Skip Blake. It's an obscure show. It's out there somewhere though. Yeah. I think it was on. I'm sure it's out there. It went worldwide. Yes. Any other questions? I gotta move away from this side. Let's have a gentleman come up here. It's not bad. He's got a deep arm swing. Yes, sir. And what? By the way, from now on, give me your names when you ask your question.
Hi, my name is John.
John.
I want to say I really enjoyed hearing you guys all beatbox the Chocobo song.
Oh, we did that, didn't we? Yeah, you guys watch our stream then, I guess, sometimes.
Yes.
Okay.
I was also wondering how you felt about doing a character like Saray, who was kind of a bit of a ruined maniac, straight-laced, and apparently liked to identify monoliths a lot.
Oh, yeah. Oh, look, a monolith! And then he'd run off into the sunset. Yeah, good question. I really liked that character because he's just like 100% like cinnamon bun, like too good for this world, sort of we have to protect him. Saray was like my first foray into like Sony, sort of shonen-y video game characters, and Wendy Lee directed me in that. And the only reason I think I got Saray is because we did Otakon together in 2014, and I met her backstage, and we did a very, very dirty after-hours panel. And I think she was just like shocked about how filthy I was, and she was like, "I like you." I was like, "Good." And then she sent me the audition for Saray, and that's how I ended up doing it. And then she was like, "Oh, you can be like clean and straight-laced." So I even talk a little higher in my voice when I talk to you guys for projection's sake. When I talk normally, my voice is down here, which is lower than Prompto, definitely lower than Saray. And then once you start putting your voice up here and making it really clean and nice, you can't help but just smile and be nice all the time. And you're like, "Oh no, you know, my family's being eaten by demons." And then you go, "Too bad, I wish we could all just live together." You know, and that sort of becomes who you are. So I still voice him every week on the anime. And every time I go back to that session, I'm like, "Man, this guy's too much." Like, literally, like, he'll watch just somebody's throat get slit in front of him and be like, "Why did you do that?" I'm like, "Because they're a murderer." He's very innocent and sweet. I like him a lot for that. Unflappably sweet. I mean, he is kind of like ancient boy Jesus. So, like, you kind of have to be cool. And he's super dumb. He's super dumb. Let me tell you right now, that is a character choice that I made. He's an idiot. Because he's lived on a mountain his whole life with a bunch of ghosts. It's not like he went to high school or anything. You know, so he just kind of like, "Hey." But I do love him. He's very sweet. Yeah. Choke bro. Well, like a real choke bro. He's got armor, he's got a little baby.
Hi, my name is Kyle.
Hi, Kyle.
And I just want you to know that there's no wrong way to love a chocobo.
Yes!
So, my question to you is actually a lot more casual. What series on Netflix do you enjoy binge watching?
Binge watching?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a nice casual question. What was the last thing I binge watched really hard was Stranger Things, of course.
Solid.
Yeah. I'm a huge Stephen King fan. He's my favorite popular author. I can't say everything. Some of this newer stuff, like I haven't read Lizzie's story, but I've read like some of his obscure shit, like Eyes of the Dragon and like his short story collections. I'm reading his new one right now. And Stranger Things is such an homage to Stephen King. That's why I love it so much. It's like Stephen King meets Steven Spielberg. What a great show. What else? I binge watch, but it wasn't on Netflix. It was on Hulu, I think, One Punch Man. Because I wanted to be in it, and everybody told me about it. So I just sit there and watched it all, and I went, "I want to be in this!" And I was trying to make phone calls. What else? I love horror stuff. I love horror movies. I don't know why. They don't scare me anymore. I just think they're fun. I like good like Oscar dramas. I just watched a zombie train movie called The Train to Busan. That's Korean. It's really good. I love Korean movies. They've just never really made a good zombie movie. They've tried a couple times, they've mostly been shit. But this one's really good. You should watch it. It just popped up like a couple weeks ago or something. It's super good.
Cool, thank you.
Yeah. This is the part where I just like, you guys are too young to remember Blockbuster. You would go into a Blockbuster or a Hollywood Video or your local video store. Mine was a Video Hut, which I always thought was funny. Like, we'd walk into a hut to go rent videos. And they would have like the employees' picks. It would be like, these are Matt's picks. And Matt would have like a bunch of different movies, you know, and you'd get a real good idea about who Matt was by what movies he watched. But yeah, that's basically what this panel turned into. Yeah, that train movie is really good though. Yes, let's go a little further. I'm just gonna keep alternating. Right there, yes. You're like full athleisure. Yeah. You got it, you can do it.
Hi.
Hi, what's your name?
My name is Marianne.
Marianne?
Yeah.
That's a nice name. What's your question, Marianne?
So, have you been into any hentai?
Been into? I don't know what we're talking about.
I mean, have you done
done hentai? Are you asking, do I watch hentai in my free time, or have I ever voiced hentai?
Have you voiced it? Yeah.
No.
Oh.
Listen, it's been presented to me. Here's why I've never voiced hentai, is because I started in cartoons. I feel like if I'd have started in anime, or like I was working my way up, I might have done some hentai on the side or something just for fun. What would my hentai nom de plume be? Ooh, I don't know. Something like Bobby Honeycutt or something like really bad. No, I've never done any hentai. Yeah. So any hopes of hearing me moaning and groaning are out the window, girl. I'm sorry. Have you ever watched hentai? But yeah, I'm a man, of course I have. If Samuel Jackson can watch it, I can watch a little bit. I mean, it's not preferred, it's not gonna pop up on my browser history, but I've seen a few. Back in my day, it was like weird stuff, like La Blue Girl. Like classic hentai. Like legit, like all the tentacle stereotypes was like all the hentai that was out like when I would have been an age where I would have watched hentai. Now, I don't know, characters getting it on, or cartoons getting it on doesn't quite do it for me, but, you know. If it does it for you, that's cool, whatever. Whatever floats your boat. Are we fully 18 plus yet? Let's do this! It's getting hot in here. But no, I haven't even done any, ecchi? Which one is it? Yeah, it's like borderline porn, right? We got boobies, no penetration. Haven't done that either. No. I think the closest thing to a boobie show I've ever done is Seven Deadly Sins. Yeah, that's about as much boobies as I'm comfortable with. Yeah. I mean, I'm comfortable with it, but I do cartoons for kids. So I'd be kind of freaked out if they were like, you know, why is Spaceway banging that lady? You know, like, that'd be weird for everyone. Yeah. I even went on my Twitter and my Facebook once I started doing cartoons and like cleaned up shop. I went back and I was like, oh boy. Yeah. There's the answer to that. Good question though. I've actually never been asked that question. Yeah, good one. Let's do, we got a prompt here. Let's do it. Come on up. Yeah.
My name is Noelle.
Hi, Noelle.
Did you know about like prompt, okay.
Spoiled,
I'm sorry. Do you know like about like
Pronto's
backstory before you voiced him?
Yes.
You did?
Beep blap bloop. Yeah. I would make that joke all the time. I would be in sessions with the director and I would just be like, and he'd be like, so his motivation here, you know, he's got this, and he's doing this, and Knox going through a really hard time, and I'd be like, yeah, I got it. Okay, here we go. Beep beep beep. Beep blap bloop. He's like, God damn it! I fucked around in those Final Fantasy sessions more than any other session ever. Because here's why. Those sessions were 4 hours long. And we had to keep the energy up and make them funny. And the director and I gelled really well. And he knew that if he let me riff for a couple of lines in between takes instead of just steamrolling through everything, that it would be funnier and it would get better. So, yeah, I did know. But I didn't play. I never played it. Until the scene. That's a hard thing to do though, because, you know, it's like when you get a movie script or a or a show script or whatever, or an audiobook or something like that, where it's a long form, and you know the ending, that's a tough actor challenge. And how do I not play the ending? And it's a trick that a lot of young actors will fall into, right? You'll watch them in the first few moments, and you know, supposedly, you know, early in the story, and maybe you know that the character kicks the bucket at the end, then you can go to them and go, why are you being so maudlin? Why are you playing this so low right now? And they go, yeah, but I know my character's really struggling with, you know, the death of his sister. And then you go, your sister doesn't die until act three. So, and that's a tough challenge. I did know, but he's human. So, in a way. So he's, Proto's got a soul, I think. So, yeah. Unlike my girlfriend, she's a ginger, so she doesn't. I'm kidding! You're recording, no! I'm teasing. I tell her that to her face all the time. Yes, other questions? Let's do sunglasses.
Yeah.
You! Nice bangs.
Thank you.
It's hard to rock some bangs.
This is my friend's
wig,
so she
did it. Yeah, it's
Hi.
Very nice. You have a good friend, and she straight up gave you credit for out of the blue.
This morning I was at college and she's like, hey, come down, like yesterday. I'm just like, well, fuck, okay.
You have like spare cosplay just laying around for your friends of all shapes and sizes? I got you. Look great.
So, speaking of college, my question is, what's the weirdest shit you've done? Oh, I'm an Amanda, by the way.
Hi, Amanda.
Hi.
I love how you bailed on your question to introduce yourself. What's the weirdest shit you have? I'm Amanda, by the way. That's how I would start job interviews. I'm here to fuck your business up. Oh, by the way, I'm Robbie. Nice to meet you. Yes, what was the weirdest stuff I did in college? Oh. Legal in what state? What's legal in Boston?
Everything.
Some girl died in our pool and then got brought back to life on the side of the pool. She did a bunch of drugs that you shouldn't mix, and then we were all upstairs and somebody went, where's so-and-so? And we all looked down at the pool and she was bobbing, like face down, like dead. So we had to pull her out of there, and somebody did CPR and brought her back to life. Don't party that hard, kids. What's the weirdest thing I've ever done personally? Ooh, I woke up. I think, well, here's the thing. I went to college in Las Vegas. So, I think a lot of my college career involved me waking up in places that I don't know why I was there. I woke up one time fully nude on a diving board. Like, all my stories are pool-centric. It's a very hot place to live. Where I was just like spread eagle, fully naked, on a diving board with like no one around at 3 in the morning. Like the party was over and I was just like a discarded solo cup. I mean, yeah. God, I once fell asleep on my own front steps until I got a booty call at like 3 in the morning and then woke up and went, I got in my car and drove to the booty call. Oh man. Ooh. We can talk, girl. We can talk. Let me just leave you with those stories. Are those good enough? Those won't get me arrested, right?
But you have more, right?
I do have lots and lots more. We should watch our stream. Sometimes I tell some stories up there that I'm not too proud of, and those are recorded. So, yeah. Good question. Yeah. Let's do... pink hair, blue glove. I don't know the theme to Lightning Returns or whatever it is. So I just went with Rocky. I don't know why.
It's fine. Hi, my name's Julie.
You are Joy?
Julie. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, general question. What's your favorite movie, actor or actress?
All-time favorite actor. That's hard. But I do have an answer. My favorite actor is, and this is going to sound very weeby, I'm sorry, is Toshiro Mifune from all of Akira Kurosawa's movies. Mostly because of how physical he is and how committed he is to every moment. If you guys, he's basically like, like Scorsese's DiCaprio. They both say that the best movies that either of them have been in, they've been in together. And Kurosawa is one of my favorite directors. I just think it's beautiful cinematically. And I really love him as an actor. For an actress, that's a tough one. There's so many good female actresses. I really like Helen Mirren. She's one of my all-time favorites. But I gotta go, like, kind of generic answer, but it's the truth. It's Meryl Streep. I mean, just committed to every, even she's in a terrible movie, and she just crushes it. She's my favorite actress for sure. Yeah? If you haven't seen Toshiro in any of those films, you should watch them. It's really a masterclass in acting. They're great. Ron is amazing, but Seven Samurai is one of the best performances I've ever seen, ever. Yeah, good question. Thank you. I love talking about Mervies. I talk for a living. Pink, the wig designer. Yes.
Hi, I'm Juliana. I have a question. It's more of a request. So when Cindy asks Prompto and everyone to go get the headlights, he says, something seems off about Cindy. She asks us, it wasn't her normal, can y'all do this for me? It was all, y'all need to do this. Could you say that?
Is that the line?
Yeah. Basically.
I'm going to do basically, because I don't remember if I'm going to do what he says. Like, let's see. What's Prompto sound like here? It's me, but higher. Okay, got it. Something seemed off with Cindy. She's not her normal self. She wasn't all, hey, could you all do this for me? She was like, y'all need to do this for me.
Thank you.
Yay! I don't even know that line. Did I say that? Cool. I hope that was good. Yes, right up front. Black. We'll get you both, but we'll do black thing first. We'll get to you, Saray. Come on. Yes, you. Yeah. Yeah. I wasn't calling you a black girl. I was saying the girl in black. You, the black girl. No. You. Just you.
Sweet
monkey.
Kaylee.
Hi, Kaylee.
First off, have you played Episode Gladio yet?
No, we're waiting to stream it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Secondly, are you planning to play Episode Prompto?
Well, duh.
Okay.
Hell yeah, I'm gonna stream it. Absolutely, I'm gonna play it, gonna stream it. I did play all of Final Fantasy. I live tweeted it. I basically was just a smelly mess for about 6 days. I just sat around playing it and eating and tweeting. So my playtime is actually really slow because like something cool would happen and I'd be like, what can I tweet about this? Which is a lot harder to do on Twitter than in real life. But yeah, definitely gonna play all the episodes. Hopefully we'll get Adam back to stream episode Ignis. Definitely I will be there with a special guest for my episode and then trying really hard to get Chris to stream episode Gladio, but he's a tough guy to get a hold of, but yeah.
Last thing, can you sing the Chocobo song?
Sure. I just want to ride my Chocobo all day. I feel like I never do that shit. I feel like it tonight. I feel good tonight. I don't know. I usually don't take requests. But I'll do it. Yeah, let's do little Saray. Yeah, come on. You look awesome, by the way.
Thanks.
Nice gear. That's the coolest sexy walk I've ever seen. I'm gonna try that next time I'm out at the bar. I'll be like, hey girl. She's gonna be like, hey, go away.
I don't think Saray can
be
sexy though. He's too pure.
I don't. Yeah, you're right. Only when
maybe
he's.
Maybe Mick Leo?
Yeah, only when Mick Leo's floating around him.
So, if Saray knew about memes.
Yes.
What would his favorite meme be?
It would be like the sad black bear panda one. You know what I mean? What is that meme? Where it's like, oh, where it's like a bear that looks sad.
Unbearably sad.
Yeah, unbearably sad. Is that the one? You really know your memes. That would be the one. It would be like Grandpa got ate by the malevolent. It's been 2 years. You played the game.
Oh, also, I didn't introduce myself, but I'm Jude.
You're what?
Jude.
Everybody's got a J name. Right? How many do we have? We've got Juliana. Take it easy. Nice to meet you. Thank you. Let's do gentlemen in the red. There is it's a low penis to vagina ratio in here. A lot of ladies in here. Yeah. Guys, your odds are good right now. I don't know. I don't know what everybody's into. Maybe not. Yeah. Go ahead. I just made your question really awkward. like the one guy, and I'm immediately like, hello, sir, penis!
Well, depending on whether or not you've voiced it already, this might already be, but...
Okay.
Tell me about Bedar. Why does he wear the mask?
I can't... Bro, I can't talk about that shit that's not out yet!
Well, then...
I don't know anything about that!
Well, then, let's reword it, then. How does it feel somehow being the best character in a show, not knowing that going in?
How did it feel being the best character in a show where I clearly die at the end of the first season and don't come back in a mysterious way in the second season?
Doesn't change you being best.
Sir, what are you talking about? Yeah, dude. For those of you who don't know, I like a false death in a show. I won't tell you which one. But to actually answer your question, I didn't know at all until that company told me. And then we were at an event and they were like, hey, you're not dead. I was like, fuck yes! I was like, I didn't want to be dead, I like this show.
Only other thing I will say is don't forgive him.
You'll see. You'll see. If things are gonna get good. It'd be really anime if I forgave him. I'm gonna try not to. I like the animes where like, the bad guys don't get redeemed and they just get straight fucking murdered. That's my kind of anime. I always hate it where I was like, you killed my family, but my friends are here to help me. And then you're like, yeah, don't you understand the power of friendship? You're so alone. You're like, all right, I am alone. Will you please be my friend? And they go, yeah, you can be friends with us. And I'm like, dude, he just killed your whole fucking planet. But that's anime. That's anime logic, man. I don't know. You tell me. I guess it's a good whatever. Is that a Krollo in the back? Yeah, Krollo's up front. I'm sorry I'm giving priority to people who cosplay me. Yeah.
So on the topic of villains, my name's Kimberly,
you.
By the way.
I remember you, Kimberly.
Yes. Hello. So about your newer roles, one of your newer roles in Hunter x Hunter and Krollo, what do you think of his character and how did you get introduced to this role?
Sneaking suspicion they were gonna put me in Hunter x Hunter at some point. I auditioned for Illumi and didn't feel right for it. I don't think my audition was very good, and obviously the casting directors thought the same because I didn't get cast. And then when Krollo came, I kind of said this in the other panel. I listened back to my audition. I rarely do this. I'm very tough on myself, but I was like, oh shit, that sounds good. I was like, I have a chance at this. And I didn't know much about the character, so then I was like, okay, cool, I get to be another anime villain, because I've played a couple of them, and I was like, this guy seems pretty likable, and then I started reading online, and I was like, oh, wow, people really do like this guy. He's a fan favorite villain, so I was like, okay, I better do a good job. And then Tony Oliver is the director, and for those of you who don't know, he's a legend in anime. I'll work with Tony any day. He's the best. And he brought me in and we started working on a few episodes and I was like, oh, this guy's dope. I love this character. Because there's a bit where, no spoilers, it's a 2011 show, I won't give any plot, but there's a bit in the show where he's reciting this piece of poetry, which I believe is a fortune, but the translation's really good. Whoever did the script adapting has wrote this really beautiful poem. And and I get to recite this beautiful poem under like this beautiful like Italian aria. So I'm like doing this poem and it's like, and all this stuff is good. There's like strings and then dudes are getting murdered everywhere. Like dudes are getting their heads popped off. And some guy that's just walking around just snapping people's necks. Like, have you ever seen like the Steven Seagal skit where he's like, hey, and he's just snapping everybody's neck? Like a character in Hunter x Hunter's like really doing that, just twisting guys' heads around, and I was like, this is awesome. It was one of those like anime is cool moments. So I really enjoyed that. And I was introduced with the character, that was just a company that I work for, Bang Zoom Studio, that does a lot of dubbing for is that who handles Hunter x Hunter, I think? But anyway, they put me in that role, and I'm really grateful for it because I've had a lot of fun with it. Yeah, we're still working on it, but it's really fun. Yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff. I'm proud of that one. Not every day is a walk in the park, or not every day is like awesome to go into work. And that sounds shitty coming from someone who's objectively has a really cool job. But you know, I want to, even if I make more money going in and selling like McFlurries or some bullshit, I would rather go in and do something artistically fulfilling for a little less money from a personal standpoint. Yeah, so I'm always having fights with my checkbook. But yeah, that's it's a cool part. I really like it. If you're not watching the show, it's a great dub on Toonami right now. Yeah. Madden. You. Oh, I remember you.
Hello.
I feel like I'm a dick. Like, oh, I remember you. I'm sorry, I didn't mean it like that. You're both wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, so... Hi, okay. So, last I remember, you're in Persona 5 as Goro.
I am.
And I just wanted to ask, Goro has a wide range of emotions on display in that game, from what I've heard.
No spoilers or people will kill you. Got it? All right, cool. Go ahead. Nice ambiguous question, though. Go on.
So, how did you kind of get in the mood to... I'll just keep brief. How do you get in the mood to play a character who displays a lot of distinct emotions? Like, they go through a lot of different emotions, but you want to keep it, like, so you, the audience and you know that it's the same character just going through a lot of different situations.
Well, that's a good actor question in general. When it's split up like that, you can sit if you'd like. Or you can stand. It's up to you. Or you want to look, let's just look at each other directly. In order to maintain a character voice and also play it in a different way, that takes one of those skill sets that we were talking about. So how, when I get mad, does it not slip out of that character? How is it still that character when he's upset, or that character when he's being very calm? And that Goro's kind of a master manipulator. So that's how I approach that character, from the standpoint of whatever he's doing in that moment is it's an old acting thing, it's strictly to get what he wants from whoever in the scene he's with. So that makes playing different moments really easy. So when he's dealing with whoever's above him, when he's dealing with her, he's like, oh yeah, hi, yeah, I'm gonna be really nice and formal with you. And then when he's on television, he puts on his television face. And then when he's dealing with the Phantom Troop 101 and wants to hang out with them, he puts on his buddy face of whoever he needs to be in that moment. So that character in particular was really easy to play moment to moment, because he always had a really clear objective in every scene. Thankfully, it's not always so... a lot of times it's in subtext. A lot of times, you know, he's asking for a cup of coffee, but what he's really doing is something else. So we had a really nice director and a really good producer who knew what was up all the time, and they would clue me in on what's really going on. And I'd be like, what's this scene all about where he's asking about, you know, curry? And I was like, oh, the curry scene. And you're like, oh shit, there's secret meaning. And then once you find that out, you can play it. Yeah. Does that help?
Oh, yeah.
Did that answer your question?
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. What's your name?
It's Sean.
Thanks, Sean. I'm Ron Burgundy? Is your name Sean? Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay, good. Get out of here. Perfect. a perfect comedy bit. Oh, yes. Let's do on the left right here. Yes. And she pranced.
Hello. I'm Joe.
Hi, Joe.
I have a couple of questions.
Yes.
First one is a little bit of a backtrack. What is your favorite Stephen King novel? And second question, on a scale of 1 to 10, how much is episode Prompto going to hurt?
I don't know yet.
Okay.
I'm not with episode Prompto, I don't know, because I haven't done it. All I've done is that breathing scene for the promo. I don't know what the plot's gonna be. I don't know who I shot. I don't know when it takes place. I don't know what's happening. I know nothing. I'm a complete idiot. That's your answer about episode Prompto. My favorite Stephen King novel is, I would say Dark Tower 2, Drawing of the Three. Yeah, I think Dark Tower is one of my favorite fantasy collections of all time. Yeah. How about right next to her? Yes, you just from her slumped shoulders when I didn't pick her. She literally went, yes.
This is actually for Joe.
Oh no, don't say that.
Well, she's turning 21 and loves Prompto probably more than they hate themselves.
Oh. All right.
And I was wondering if you could tell them happy birthday in Prompto's voice.
Sure. Who's who for whom? For Joe?
For Joe.
Just for Joe. When's your birthday? 21?
Yeah, Monday.
Monday. Let's see. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joe. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday from Monday. Yay, who's next? Dun, 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 dun,
dun, dun. So I have a request because I'm on the Loud Annoying Discord.
Yay! Weird stuff happens there. I don't go on that.
They're all so awesome, like Scala and...
They're great.
Pokemon Chi specifically asked me to say hi, but could I take a video of you saying hi to the Discord?
Let's do it quick. Are you ready?
Alright.
Hi Lava Discord, hi Pokemon Cheese and everyone else. I love you guys, thank you for all of your hard work and silliness and inappropriate stuff that happens behind our back. Bye.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And then for a question, I wanted to know if you had to survive a zombie apocalypse and you could take three people with you, fictional, living, dead, or otherwise, who would you pick and why?
Fictional, living, dead, or otherwise.
Yes.
To survive the zombie apocalypse? All right, I'm taking my dog. I gotta let my cat free. Because that cat's gonna be a liability. He'll be fine. He'll catch some birds. He'll be done. My dog is 70 pounds. She'll fuck some zombies up. But that's not people. I would have to... But are my loved ones safe?
Yes.
Okay, my loved ones are safe. All right, well, I'm not taking my girlfriend because she's a liability. She'll be fine, as long as she's a loved one. just to survive. So I'm separated and I gotta pick three people to go. Okay, I am gonna take, oh, this is really hard. Fictional, well, but I'm not gonna do superpowers because that's too easy, or I just pick Superman and I just have him kill everyone, all the zombies around me. I'm gonna take Roland from the Dark Tower, absolutely, since we're talking about it, because I feel like he would just fuck shit up. And I would take some really, really smart, but kind of devious. I would probably take, this is so hard, I'm thinking too hard about it. I'm out on this. This is so hard. I can't do it. You're asking me to pick from all of known humanity in fiction. Alright, I'll pick Roland from the Dark Tower, Harry Potter, and Superman. Got it. Great. I'm gonna be fine with that squad. Yes, Princess Serenity. Again. Oh wait, did I already call on you? Yes. Are you sure?
Yes.
Alright. Was there somebody else dressed in the clothes? I don't know. I'm losing my mind, you guys.
Hi.
Hello.
I'm Cameron.
Hi, Cameron.
I have kind of two questions. Did you get around to watching the Final Fantasy Brotherhood anime?
No.
Oh.
I watched... I'm sorry. Don't be mad.
So do you know anything about Prompto and Luna and, like, how they... No?
I watched the Beckett episode because I thought it was touching. I really liked that episode. It was so sweet. I did watch that one, but not all of it. Just my parts. I think I'm a little bitter that we didn't get to dub it.
So, in some place, Prompto got to say something to Luna, what do you think he would say to her?
Oh, I don't know, make my friend happy. Yeah, it depends on the timeline. But probably make my friend happy. Yeah, yeah. You guys ever, like, kind of been in love with somebody and they ended up dating your friends? That's a hard thing. It's tough. Yeah. Wah, wah. Anyway, panel's over. There's free Vicodin at the door. You'll feel better. Let's see. We have 9 minutes. How about everyone who's got a question, line up and we'll do a lightning round. How does that sound? Yeah? Got a question, line up. Unless there's no questions left. Yeah, line up if you have a question. We'll do a lightning round. Yeah, we got 10 minutes. I'll get through all the questions. Oh my gosh, everyone's cosplay is great. Everyone looking stunning.
Can I go?
What?
Can I go?
You may.
All right.
No, there's only like 10 of you. I have like a minute for everybody's questions.
Sweet. All right, so I'm gonna preface this by saying I was abandoned by my real squad.
Uh-oh.
They make me angry with me for asking this question because they're super embarrassed. But what is your opinion on Prompto and Noxus' relationship?
What, like, Like touching wieners and stuff?
Your opinion, I just wanna know.
Listen, it's not canon, but whatever makes you guys happy. That's what the internet's for. I'm all for all the shipping, all the fan fiction, all the fan art, do whatever you want. I trust stay away from Yowie, it's not for me, but if you guys are into it, whatever. Well, I mean, whatever. Two cute boys kissing? If I were a chick or lean that way, I'd be into it. Yeah, yeah. They're friends. And they're college age, so maybe there's some experimenting. Who knows? I'm pretty sure things stayed above board in the tent, though. Yeah, whatever you guys want. It's fiction. It's whatever you want to make of it. So enjoy it. Yes.
Hello. My name is Wyatt. I just need to ask because you mentioned it earlier, and then no one brought it up, and I just need to know. With all the goddamn banter that is in Final Fantasy XV between Prompto and everyone else, how is there stuff that didn't make the cut, and what stuff, what made it not make the cut in a game about stuff that sounds like it shouldn't make the cut?
That's very loaded. Sit down! No, I'm kidding. I have no idea. I don't make those kind of decisions. I just try to make whatever's the lines are funniest be funny, and whatever's not that ends up on the cutting room floor, who knows? It's not my job. There was some pretty weird stuff in there, and some of it I didn't hear, so I'm maybe glad that it's gone. Who knows? Hopefully they made good decisions. I don't know. Banter's part of Final Fantasy. I ever since 10, I love it. But who knows? Yeah, this isn't very much of a lightning round. Oh my god, lightning round!
Okay, two questions. One, are you going to any conventions in the Midwest? That's where I'm from. Where?
I'm from St. Louis. I'm doing.
What's up?
Yeah, woo-hoo! I've not been there in a long time. I would love to go to Anime St. Louis. Tell them that I want to go.
Okay, secondly, Marvel or DC?
Marvel.
Thank you.
Oh, my name's Shelby, by the way.
Hi, Shelby.
I didn't tell you that during the Blue Switch shoot.
I know.
Okay, so what's your favorite Stephen King movie?
Original made-for-TV, It.
Okay, have you seen the trailer for the new one?
I have. Here's what I'm scared about. I'm just frightened that they're not going to make him playful enough and he's become like a bad horror movie monster. That's
okay.
What I'm afraid of. As long as he has the playfulness of that character, I hope. We'll see.
Okay, that's what I wanted your opinion on.
Yeah!
Hi, Monica.
Hi, Monica. You look fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm going to show you a webcomic of, it's called Four Guys in a Car. I'm going to show you one of them.
Seen a lot of it. Show me the panel. Which one is it? Okay. Yeah? Something like that. Some sort of squeeing noise that it's too late at night for me to make. Oh, he's hugging a chocobo. Oh no, I didn't see that! No! That's what he would say. can't eat chocobo. I ate a kangaroo in Australia. I felt so guilty, you guys. But it was delicious. Yeah, go ahead.
Up or down?
I'm just gonna sit here.
Scared what that means. I'll go with up. Top or bottom, I know the answer to. I'm kidding. Come on. Yes.
Hi, I'm Bucky.
Hi, Bucky.
Dream roll. Any part you play,
I'm playing it right now.
All
right. I just can't tell you what it is.
Okay.
Stick with me online and you'll find out within the year. Literally my all-time dream roll I'm doing right now. I love you guys. I'm sorry. I'll tell you this. It relates to one of the questions that was asked tonight. Not in the anime world. Go ahead.
So what's your favorite part, like, about Prompto and Noctis's, like, whole relationship dynamic?
The fact that Prompto tries to lift everyone up, even though he's the weakest of all of them. And, yeah. Well, I guess that was a good answer. Next! You look lovely.
Thanks. My name is Steven, and who do you like to ship Prompto with?
A mirror image of Prompto? Cindy, of course. That's the love of his life. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Cindy's my girl. I do love sending.
Hi.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Katrina.
Hi, Katrina.
I'm just wondering, I know it might be hard to choose, but out of all the roles you've played, kind of which was, I suppose, your most challenging and most difficult, and which was your most favorite and you felt was easiest to do?
Prompto's definitely the easiest. Prompto is a lot of me. That's what I was saying earlier. There's a lot more, I do a lot more stretchy characters than that. And I love him very much, but, you know, he's just a version of me, like a lot of characters are. But he's more me, I think, than any other character that I've played. One of the hardest things I ever did was one of my shows on Nickelodeon, Breadwinners. And the reason it was hard was because it was high energy, punch you in the face the whole time. I had to sing. It was just 4 hours for an 11-minute cartoon, sugar cereal, just hey kids, for 4 hours. It was hard. But I love that show. And the internet hates it. And I say, fuck the internet. Because I love that show. And you know who loves that show? Like 6 to 8 year old boys. You know who we made that show for? 6 to 8 year old boys. So the rest of the internet can go, yeah.
Mission accomplished.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm
Emily. Hi, Emily.
So dubs can be kind of silly sometimes. Was there ever a line that you read the script that you were like,
in a dub?
Or any
like 10% of them. No, anything that's too like hero-y tropey kind of makes my vomit come up a little bit. Yeah, anyone that's like pretty much, you know, one of those speeches I was doing before, like, oh god, just I'm not good enough, but I believe in myself. Even though Moomin Rider is like, that's all he is, and I love him. So I don't know. It's hard to pick. There are a few bad ones out there. Oh boy. Yes.
Hi, I'm Nikki.
Hi, Nikki. Are you just cool, or are you like low-key Prompto? I can't tell.
I wish I was cool. No, I'm a Fenris of Dragon Age.
Oh, there you go. You look awesome.
Thank you. I think
maybe Prompto stole that character style. Yeah.
From back in your theater days, what was your favorite performance that you did?
Ooh, my favorite performance is a play called Floyd Collins. It's a music by Adam Gittell about a guy around the turn of the century who gets trapped in a cave. And spends the entire 2.5 hour play slowly dying in a cave. But it is beautiful. If you guys can snag the soundtrack or find it on YouTube or something, it's one of the most beautiful musicals you'll ever listen to. And I got to play Floyd along with my best friend and roommate at the time, Steve Booth, who's now a big star on Broadway. So scoobly boobity, that was my favorite play I ever did. Final question, all the pressure's on you. It better be good. What's your question gonna be?
Hi, my name's Megan. I have a silly question, so I hope it's good enough.
What is it?
You said you had a cat and a dog, but if you could own a chocobo in real life, would you?
Yes, and my dog's name is Zelda, and my cat's name is Link, and I would name my chocobo Ganondorf. You guys were a lot of fun. Go party, go get weird, be safe. Kiss a stranger, don't drink too much, and if you're around tomorrow, come see me at my other panels and signings. You guys are awesome. Thank all of you.